الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. قال المؤلف رحمه الله: واعرف لبني هاشم فضلهم لقرابتهم من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، واعرف فضل قريش والعرب وجميع الأفراد، واعرف قدرهم وحقوقهم في الإسلام ومولى القوم منهم، وتعرف لسائر الناس حقهم في الإسلام. The author رحمه الله here is speaking about the noble tribes of the Arabs, the tribe of Bani Hashim, the children of Hashim. From them came the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So they are a noble tribe due to the fact that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from them. So they are Bani Hashim. And Bani are the children, like Bani Israel, the children of Israel. And Israel is Yaqub, Jacob, Yaqub, alayhi salam. So Bani Hashim are the children of Hashim. From them came our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we have to give them their respect. We have to give them their due respect. Likewise, we have to give Quraysh. Because the Quraysh also, that the tribe the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came from. He came from Quraysh. And that's why in his lineage you say Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Hashimi al-Qurashi. Al-Hashimi al-Qurashi. So he is from the children of Hashim, and he is from Quraysh, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, and those who came from that lineage. So we must know their rights in Islam. We must know their rights in Islam. Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, hafidhahullah ta'ala, he said the children of Hashim are the children of Hashim ibn Abdi Manaf, the son of Abd Manaf. So Hashim is the son of Abd Manaf. He said, لأن عبد مناف له أولاد هم هاشم. So this man, Abd Manaf, he has children. From them is Hashim, this son. And Hashim happens to be the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah. So now you know who his Hashim is. So Hashim is the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is another one, Wa'abdu Shams. There's another one, Abd Manaf. This Abd Manaf, he had children. And one of them is Hashim. And Hashim is the grandfather of the Messenger of Allah. And there is another one, Abdu Shams. Jad Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. He was the grandfather of Uthman ibn Affan. You see, Uthman is also from that tribe as well. طيب. ونوفل بن عبد مناف. And there is another one. There's another child that he had. نوفل ibn عبد مناف. He said, جد حكيم بن حزام. He is the grandson of حكيم ibn حزام. حكيم ibn حزام رضي الله عنه. والمطلب ابن عبد المناف. There is another one, مطلب ابن عبد المناف. جد بني المطلب. He is the grandfather of بني المطلب, the children of المطلب. هؤلاء هم أولاد عبد المناف. All these are the children of عبد المناف. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بعث في بني هاشم بن عبد المناف. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was sent among the children of Hashim. Among the children of Hashim. فهو هاشمي قرشي. So the Prophet ﷺ is هاشمي, means he's from the children of Hashim, and he's قرشي because from the tribe of Quraysh. And this is very common until today. You find like one of the scholars, like for example, Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, when they mention his name, they say At-Tamimi. At-Tamimi means comes from this tribe, Bani Tamim, the children of Tamim. So he comes from that tribe. And sometimes you hear Al-Qahtani, right? Al-Qahtani, he comes from Qahtan. Because the Arabs, they have tribes. They have tribes. You see? And when it comes to the science of the Quran, there's a benefit I want to share with you so that you know that the Arabic language is very vast. It's a very vast language. Now, the Arabs, if some of the tribes, if they want to tell you, come here, for example, in English you say, come on, come here, that's all you have, right? But in Arabic, there are different ways to say that. I don't know about Chinese, but in Arabic, you know, we have different way to say, come here. So it depends on the tribe. Like, for example, certain tribe, they will tell you, ta'ala. Ta'ala, this is very common. Ta'ala means come in, come here. Our tribe, they don't say ta'ala, they say halumma. Halumma. You see, it's different. But it means the same thing. And another tribe will not say ta'ala or halumma, they will say aqbil. You see? There are three different, you know, ways of saying come here. Just depend on the tribe. It depends on the tribe. So the tribe, they use certain words that others don't use. You know? It's like in Urdu and Hindi. In Urdu and Hindi. So they have certain words that they're not even Hindi or Urdu. They are Arabic. Like, for example, when they say, what time is it? They say, kya waqt hai? Kya waqt hai? What time is it? Kya waqt hai? And waqt is Arabic word. Waqt is Arabic. So what time is it? What time is it? For example, they use makan. Makan is Arabic word. Makan is a place. Dukan. Dukan is what?
Shop
is Arabic word, but they use it in Hindi and Urdu. They use also muhabbat. Muhabbat. Muhabbat means love. But it's taken from mahabba, Arabic. You see how deep Arabic can go. Also, the word, for example, Adami. Adami. Adami is a human being. Taken from Adam. Adami. Yeah, ye Admi. Ye Admi means this man, right? So they use a lot of Arabic words because of the Islam that entered India. The influence of Islam that entered India. And also the Mughals, they had an army that consists of Arabic speaking and Urdu and the Persian speaking. Persian and Hindi. So that's how Urdu came about. That's why you find Hindi words, you find Arabic words, you find also Persian words. Like, for example, zindagi. Zindagi is a Persian word, which is life. Life. And janamaz. Janamaz, they use it for prayer rug, right? Janamaz. Namaz is a Persian word, which is salat. Roza, which is fast, is a Persian word, you see? Yeah, Rosa, yeah. So they use this a lot. So you see the influence of the languages. Going back to our class, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith, "Inna Allah astafa kinanata min waladi Ismail." He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen this man Kinana. He has chosen him, it means he has favored him. Aman, the people, he chose him from the children of Ismail. Ismail is who? Peace be upon him. Ismail is the son of Ibrahim. Peace be upon them. Wastafa min kinanata Quraysh. And he chose from Kinana, he chose Quraysh. The tribe Quraysh came from him. Wastafa min Quraysh bani Hashim. And he chose from Quraysh itself the children of Hashim. You see? The nobility. Look at the nobility. وَاصْطَفَانِي مِنْ بَنِي هَاشِمْ. And he has favored me from the children of Hashim. So Allah did not choose anyone except the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he's the best of the best. He's the best of the best, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was the most noble of them all. And also, in terms of eloquence of speech, there was no one who could speak better than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even though he was illiterate. That was the really, amazing that he was illiterate, but yet he had the most eloquent tongue. He had the most eloquent tongue, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And even before Islam, before the revelation came to him, he was known for his truthfulness. Allahu Akbar. And he was known to be very trustworthy. So they used to call him As-Sadiq Al-Amin. As-Sadiq is the one who is truthful. He never lies, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Al-Amin is the one who is trustworthy. So much so that they used to leave their valuable with him. They would leave their valuable with him. So it's like, basically it was like a bank for them, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like a safety deposit bank. So they would leave their valuable with him. They come back and they find it exactly how they left it. So he was known to be a person who never lies. And he was reliable and trustworthy, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before Islam. And he never prostrated to an idol or anything like that. As a matter of fact, he didn't like what his people were doing. Because he was upon fitrah. He was upon the natural inclination. And he used to go to the cave of Hira. He was seeking the truth. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him. And he sent Jibreel to him while he was in the cave of Hira. And Jibreel, of course, when he meets the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does not come in his angelical form. He does not come in his angelical form. Because you know that Jibreel, peace be upon him, is extremely massive. He's extremely massive. When the Prophet ﷺ saw him in his angelical form, imagine, in his angelical form, he had 600 wings that covered the horizon. Imagine. Subhanallah, you cannot even imagine. 600 wings that covered the horizon. But he would come to him in the form of a man. Like when he was with the companions, Ridwanullahi alayhim. And then Umar radiallahu anhu narrates, he said, we were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and a man came out of nowhere. This man, he were wearing clothings that were exceedingly white, very, very clean and white. And his hair was exceedingly black. And there was no sign of journey upon this man. Because usually when someone is traveling, you could tell that this person is traveled by looking at him disheveled, for example, or his clothes are kind of wrinkly or something like that. You would know that this person has been traveling. But this is not the case. So they were amazed at this man. And no one knew him from amongst them. No one knew him. And then he asked the Prophet ﷺ about the five pillars of Islam, six pillars of Iman. And then he asked him about Ihsan. He asked him about some of the signs of the hour, right? And in the end, when he left, the Prophet ﷺ, he told Umar radiallahu anhu, do you know who the questioner was? He said, Allah and His Messenger know best. So it is permissible to say that at the time of the Messenger of Allah, but not now. You cannot say Allah and His Messenger know. Some people say this. This is incorrect. You can say Allah knows best. But at that time, because the Prophet was alive and he would receive the revelation, so it's permissible to say it while he was living. But after he died, we say only Allah knows best. طيب, then he said, Allah and His Messenger know best. He said that was Jibreel. He came to teach you your religion. Allahu Akbar. So he came to teach not only the companions of Ridwanullahi alayhim, the whole ummah. Because he asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very important questions that have to do with the fundamental principles of Islam and the Iman. طيب فهؤلاء هم قرابة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Shaykh, he said, these are the relatives of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. المؤمنون من بني هاشم. Look how specific the Shaykh is. He said the believers from the children of Hashim. He does not include what? The disbelievers. Only the believers. Because even if they were close to the Messenger of Allah, but they disbelieved in the message, they will not be considered his close relatives. Even though in terms of the lineage, yes, but they are not really from him. They are not really from him. طيب. هؤلاء هم القرابة الذين لهم حق على المسلمين. He said these are the relatives of the Messenger of Allah that the Muslims have a right upon them. Have a right upon them. تحرم عليهم الصدقة وتباح لهم الهدية. He said the relatives of the Messenger of Allah, it is haram upon them to receive charity. You understand? It is haram upon them to receive charity because it does not befit their status. It does not befit their status. Because they are from the elite. You know, from the elite. Have you ever seen some of the elite going and getting charity? It's very humiliating. Very humiliating. So it's not permissible for them to accept charity. But al-hadiyya is okay. Al-hadiyya is what? Gift. You give them a gift, they accept it. So it is not permissible to give them charity. You see, but if you give them a gift, they will accept it. They will accept it. That's why the Messenger of Allah, he did not accept charity. He did not accept charity, but he would accept what? Gift. Like for example, when the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, remember the story of the scorpion sting. Anybody remember that?
No.
Can you share with us some benefit? Towards the end of it, when they went back to Medina, you know the villages paid them.
They paid them, I think,
a flock of sheep.
A flock of sheep.
Then they went back to the Messenger of Allah.
Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam request some?
Yes, he told them, "Give me my share."
Because he taught them the Makiyah.
Because exactly, and it was what? It was a recompensation for what they have done. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he read Surah Al-Fatiha upon that man who was, subhanallah, but look at the effect of one surah, subhanallah, Surah Al-Fatiha. He recited Surah Al-Fatiha upon the man who was stung by a scorpion, and he got up, like the narration said, he got up like a camel that got loose. You know when the camel got loose? What do they do? You see them like springing into action, you know, like that. Subhanallah Rabin. This, look at this. Amazing. Look at the power of the Quran too. But also the person who reads it has to be somebody with strong iman. That, and he believes for certainty that Allah will cure that person. Yeah, it shouldn't be like having doubt and things like that. No. Look, subhanallah. Because back then they didn't have like hospital like today. You're going to call 911. They're going to come and take him to the ER or something like that to give him an anti-venom or something like that. But subhanAllah, look at this. There was no anti-venom back there or anything like that. Quran. The Quran was a cure. Allahu Akbar. Amazing. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he told them, when they told him what happened, he said, how did you know that the Fatiha was Ruqya? And then he said, give me my share. Because this was not sadaqah. It was not sadaqah. It was a gift that they gave them as a recompensation for treating their leader. Because the people, they tried, you know, to treat him, but nothing worked. So they went to the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, and they asked them to do it, and they did it. طيب. The Shaykh, he said, حفظه الله تعالى أما غير المؤمنين فلا قيمة لهم لو كانوا من بني هاشم. The Sheikh, he said, other than the believers, they have no value in the sight of Allah, even if they were from the children of Hashim. Imagine, like Abu Lahab. تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب. سبحان الله العظيم. Even though this man, he was the uncle of the messenger of Allah, but with Allah, he doesn't have any value. He does not have any, even if he's very close to the messenger of Allah, it would not benefit him. It would not benefit him. But look at Bilal radiallahu anhu. Bilal al-Habashi from Abyssinia radiallahu anhu. Look, the Prophet ﷺ, he gave him one of the most noble job, is to call the Adhan for the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at Islam. Islam doesn't have any prejudice, doesn't have any bias, doesn't have any racism, doesn't have any anything like that. When you have what it takes, you are the leader. That's it. It doesn't matter. That's why Abu Bakr, Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to say, Abu Bakr is our leader and he set free our leader, Bilal radiallahu anhu. He used to say this, Abu Bakr Sayyiduna. وَأَعْتَقَ سَيِّدَنَا. Abu Bakr is our leader. And he set free our leader Bilal radiallahu anhu. Because Abu Bakr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, blessed him with wealth. But what did he do with it? He spent it fi sabilillah. Some people, they have billions. Subhanallah, they're very stingy. They will squeeze a penny to death. وَالْعِيَدُ بِاللَّهِ يَعُودُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ دَهِ. They love wealth. They don't do anything good with it until they die, and only those that hate them, unfortunately, take all their wealth. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests them with a disease that confuses and baffles doctors. They can't find any cure for it, so he has to spend all his billions. Subhanallah. So look at the Sahaba radiallahu alayhi. They lived in this world to work for the hereafter. So they use this world as a vehicle for the next. الشيخ said, إنما إذا اجتمع القرابة مع الإيمان فلا شك أنهم يمتازون على غيرهم. He said, if they are believers from the children of Hashim and they are close to the messenger of Allah, of course they are better than other than them. And الشيخ الألباني, I will conclude by this. الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله, he said, if there are two leaders, one of them is from Quraysh, and the other one is from another tribe, like Hawazin, for example, or Hudal, or any of the tribes, the other tribes. But the one in from Quraysh, he has more expertise than the one from Hudal. Then, of course, the leader is from Quraysh. But if the one from Hawazin is better in terms of leadership, then he will be the leader. And one example I want to share with you is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. And I want you to reflect upon this ayah. And I'm sure you read it. Some of you must have read it. Some of you did not read it. طيب. It's about the children of Israel after Musa, peace be upon him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a prophet after Musa. His name is Samuel. Samuel, right? So Samuel, the children of Israel, they came to him and they requested from him to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send them a leader so that they can fight under his banner. He said, I fear that if Allah send a leader to you, you will not fight. Subhanallah. They said, how can we not fight? We have been kicked out of our homes and our land. And our women and children have been taken captives because Goliath and his army, they will go and attack them and things like that. So he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send them a leader. Then he came to them and he said, Allah has chosen for you a leader, Talut. Okay, Talut, look, subhanallah, the standards, they are not human standards. The standards are the standards of Allah. Because we're human being, we will make wrong decisions. You know, because of materialism, you understand? We look at a person because he has a degree, because he has more wealth and things like that. So now, Allah, he told them, Allah has chosen Talut as a leader over you. Now they're going to do what? They're going to complain. They said, how can he be a leader over us? And we are more worthier than him. And he hasn't been given a lot of wealth. Ah, here we go. Look what he told them. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ. He said, Allah has chosen you, chosen him over you. And he has given him strength, physical strength and knowledge. So he had knowledge of warfare and he was a very strong, physically strong. And this is what it takes. Now all those that were running their mouth, now he's going to test them now. So Talut, he takes them to the desert. He tells them, Allah has tested you with a river. If you drink until you have your full, until you have your fill, you're going to go back. You're not coming with me. But if you scoop just a little bit and you drink a little bit, it's okay. So what did Allah say? فَشَرِبُوا مِنْهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِنْهُمْ. Majority of them, they had their fill, except a few. It shows you that numbers are not the consideration. The consideration is those who are patient and those who are steadfast. And those are very few. Because everybody can claim what they want to claim. But when the test comes, that's when you see the believer from those who are liars. Now, majority of them, they drunk, then they had their fill. He had to send them away. So only a few remained with him. And amongst the few was a boy. Subhanallah. Was a boy. His name is Dawood. This is Prophet Dawood, peace be upon him. Look, he was young. So he had a showdown with Goliath. Imagine, this guy is a giant. You know, probably Goliath was like, are you kidding me? You're bringing me a boy like this? So he had a slingshot. He hit Goliath one time and killed him. The army was defeated. That's it, done. See? How many times a small group of people defeat a large group of people? Allahumma as-sabirin. And Allah with those who are patient. Allahu Akbar. And then after that, Allah gave his kingdom to who? Dawood. And then his son, Sulaiman. Peace be upon him. You see, righteousness leads to what? Leads to blessings. And sinfulness leads to what? Destruction. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi' والعمل الصالح الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.